We've been talking about GFCIs since 1971, so why yet another video on GFCIs today? Well, in true National Electrical Code fashion, the 2023 edition continues to expand the requirements around GFCIs to provide electrical shock protection, your last resort when it comes to touching something that is energized. GFCIs have experienced much expansion since their introduction into the NEC, and the 2023 edition did not disappoint. The fact is that we are still losing people, not just electrical workers, to electrical shock, and the GFCI is a life-saving technology. The requirements you see in the NEC are the response, unfortunately, to statistics gathered of those who have lost their life due to electrical shock. There are no cases of where a person was electrocuted when on a GFCI protected circuit. NEC 2023 has brought some new requirements and a different perspective on how we think about GFCI requirements and the shock hazard. These new requirements just may impact your next project. We're going to explore this topic as we journey through section 210.8 for GFCI protection and NEC 2023 changes. To select the right device for any requirement in the code, we leverage defined terms. Remember, this can be a circuit breaker or a receptacle type GFCI. The definition of a GFCI tells us that when we use the term GFCI, anywhere in the NEC, it refers to a device that is intended for the protection of personnel functioning to de-energize a circuit or portion of the circuit within an established period of time when that ground fault current exceeds the values established for a Class A device. If you look at Article 100, you will see that there is a new type GFCI, the special purpose GFCI, that could cause some confusion. The definition of a special purpose GFCI tells us that these devices are Class C, D, or E devices. Now, this distinction is important because the parent text of Section 210.8 requires the use of a Class A GFCI, which is clearly not a special purpose GFCI. In fact, the NEC now makes it clear it must be a listed Class A GFCI. Requiring a GFCI to be listed may sound new, but I would argue it's not a new practice. Look at a GFCI device. You'll see it's listed. This requirement is more of an emphasis on the importance of identifying and using the right device for the job, especially considering new solutions entering the code. We're going to leave the details around the differences between a Class A, C, D, and E GFCI to another discussion on a different day. You have for this discussion what you need to make sure you select the right device for the job. Once we know what device to pick, the next step is to understand the difference between GFCI protection of receptacle outlets and GFCI protection of outlets. Again, we go back to Article 100, which tells us an outlet is a point on the wiring system at which current is taken to supply utilization equipment. A receptacle outlet is an outlet where one or more receptacles are installed. The big difference is that a receptacle outlet that is GFCI protected will provide protection for cord and plug equipment that is plugged into the receptacle. GFCI protected outlets provide shock protection for hardwired equipment, not cord and plug connected. Section 210.8, first level subdivisions A, B, and E are examples of where only receptacle outlets are addressed. First level subdivisions C, D, and F are examples of where GFCI requirements address outlets, picking up hardwired equipment and appliances. You see, some of the changes we see in 210.8 sought to address the real hazard. What do I mean by that? In 210.8A, for example, measurements are made from the receptacle to the sink to determine what receptacle outlets should be GFCI protected. One would think that the receptacle is the hazard because we're so concerned with the distance of this device from a sink. The hazard is what is plugged in to the receptacle. We measure from the receptacle because that's the device that is there at rough-in and final inspections. The inspector can easily identify and enforce the requirements. The problem that was presented was the fact that an appliance could be within 6 feet of the sink, but the receptacle for the appliance is outside of 6 feet of the sink. And oh, by the way, the appliance could be hardwired. In both cases, GFCI protection is not required, but the hazard is still the same. Substantiation for changes came in the form of CPSC data. The data showed that appliances become a shock hazard for many reasons outside of the control of the manufacturer of those appliances. They are worked on while energized, while troubleshooting, abused and misused, and in some cases, just the end of life of the appliance was the source of the electrical hazard, which either took a life or severely injured someone. It was clear that when hardwired, the hazard did not mysteriously disappear. This issue was addressed in four different sections, 210.8 A, B, D, and F. Let's review these significant changes so you understand what must be provided on your next project. Let's start with first level subdivision A, which pertains to dwelling unit receptacle outlets. The challenge was to address this real hazard and not key off of the receptacle distance from the sink. One solution, which you'll see in 210.8B, is addressing the proximity of fixed in place or stationary appliances and their distance from a sink, but in a dwelling unit. This just did not seem practical. Often, the appliance is not present during inspections. The code panel expanded GFCI beyond just the receptacle outlets serving countertops in kitchens to any receptacle outlet found in a kitchen. Remember, the 2020 NEC removed the 15 amp and 20 amp circuit requirement from 210.8A. So this requirement for kitchen receptacle outlets covers all receptacle outlets, picking up any cord and plug connected appliance that may be found in the kitchen. Stoves, refrigerators, ovens, microwaves. Bottom line, if it is a receptacle outlet and it's in the kitchen, GFCI protect that circuit. The second issue was hardwired appliances that may be found in basically any location. Remember, the appliance was the concern and not the receptacle, and the use of an appliance is not limited to just kitchens. So, the panel focused on section 210.8D, which addresses specific appliances. First, it was made crystal clear that we are talking about GFCI in the branch circuit being a circuit breaker or a wiring device solution, not in the cord of the appliance. Second, the list of appliances grew beyond reflecting just what is in section 422.5. The panel added more specific appliances because the data from the CPSC showed we needed it. The additional appliances include electric ranges, wall-mounted ovens, counter-mounted cooking units, clothes dryers, and microwave ovens. This section doesn't care if it's cord and plug connected or hardwired, GFCI protect this equipment. Finally, in 210.8F, the NEC addresses outdoor outlets. This section is pretty controversial because of the fact that GFCI technology is unforgiving and it has expanded beyond just 15 amp and 20 amp circuits. Some equipment intentionally or unintentionally uses the equipment grounding conductor as a current return path. This is just not good for compatibility with a GFCI. So NEC 2023 has changes around expansion and consideration for compatibility. Let's hit the cliff notes for 210.8F for expansion. First, we're only talking about dwellings. Second, in addition to outdoor outlets of dwellings, you have the outdoor outlets in garages that have floors located at or below grade level, accessory buildings, and boathouses. The kicker here is that they added a requirement such that if equipment supplied by an outlet covered under the requirements of this section is replaced, the outlet shall be supplied with GFCI protection. With regard to compatibility, there is one exception that you need to know about. Exception number 2 to 210.8F is such that listed HVAC equipment installed outdoors in these locations that we talked about is not required to be GFCI protected. The expiration date on this exception is September 1st, 2026. This gives some breathing room for manufacturers of HVAC equipment to bring their products in compliance with Article 250, which focuses on grounding and bonding and prohibits objectionable current on the equipment grounding conductor. Standards and products both have to change. Other important changes that you need to know about in 210.8 are subtle yet very important. First, a requirement found in 210.8b was added to 210.8a. This includes areas with sinks and permanent provisions for food preparation, beverage preparation, or cooking. This is not a kitchen because the definition of a kitchen says and cooking. This requirement says or cooking. In my opinion, it's going to be rare to find this type of application in a dwelling unit that's not already required to have GFCI protection for other reasons, but keep your eye out on this one. The exceptions in 210.8 also received some attention for clarity's sake and to align with the NEC style manual. Here are the cliff notes. First, all of the exceptions were moved to the end of each of the first level subdivisions. Second, some exceptions were expanded as the panel realized that some of these exceptions only applied to a specific location in the dwelling unit, but that really wasn't appropriate. As an example, the exception for fire alarm and burglar alarm systems only applied to the basement, but the panel asked the question, why only the basement? By moving the exception, it now applies to all locations identified for GFCI protection. This occurred in a few instances, so keep your eye out for that. Oh, by the way, they changed the burglar alarm to security system to correlate with other NFPA documents. Thirdly, you will see that the panel removed the reference to fire alarm systems from an exception because that exception is already addressed in Article 760. No need to duplicate requirements. Finally, you'll see that the panel aligned exception 3 with the defined terms weight supporting ceiling receptacles and weight supporting attachment fittings. Just a detail for consistency and clarity's sake. So GFCI requirements found in section 210.8 have continued to expand to address statistics around electric shock. Unfortunately, many of the requirements that we've just reviewed were all driven by statistics from data, including that from the Consumer Product Safety Commission. Electricity doesn't discriminate. Electrical workers, homeowners, other contractors not associated with the electrical industry all can experience the ill effects of electricity should they ever touch something that is energized. It's important that we understand these requirements and their impact on our installations, and remember, we can always go above and beyond the bare minimum requirements to make our installations safer. Thanks for joining in on this session, and I hope you learned something that can help you make your next installation safer and in compliance with the NEC. If you'd like to learn more about electrical safety and NEC requirements, contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to one of Eaton's Power Systems Experience Centers today.